Welcome to Hello Foodservice, the web TV show that covers the stories the industry talks about. Ask just about anyone and they'll tell you a story about a chef who can't cope without a daily cocaine fix, or the restaurateur whose morning coffee is always laced with a couple of shots of brandy. With the antisocial hours and constant stress, drugs and alcohol are a problem. However, getting someone to talk about it openly wasn't easy.
Lots of people pointed the finger at other people, but we had to go to the other side of the world to find someone to fess up. Philip Howard is an award-winning chef and co-owner of The Square, the two Michelin-star restaurant which has become a cornerstone of high-end dining in London since it opened in 1991. Back in those early days, though, he couldn't get through the day without snorting cocaine.
There's no two ways about it. The fact that I was prepared to take drugs in the first place comes down to me as an individual, but very much the reality of my life at the time was unbelievable pressure, and that was the kind of the catalyst where it all started to go horribly wrong, and it was very much actually primarily exhaustion was the key thing, and in the short term, drugs solved that problem.
So you were 23 at the time, and you found yourself almost promoted beyond your level of capability. Would that be fair to say?
Yeah, very much so. It was an extraordinary chain of events that led to me taking on The Square, and there's no two ways about it. I was full of ambition and passion. There was bucket loads of all lots of good stuff there, but the hard facts were I was grossly inexperienced as a chef. I was grossly inexperienced as a human being, actually, to take on the responsibilities of trying to set up and manage and lead a kitchen.
And how did you find taking the drugs helped?
Well, you know, the fact of the matter is, you know, we're all human beings. I had issues of, I'd recently got married. I was trying to run a new business. And so there was real huge demands on me huge demands on me as a human being. I was working with unbelievable hours, trying to keep my young, lovely new wife at home happy, and so there was very little sleep going on, so long and short of it. And so taking cocaine ultimately relieved a huge amount of, it took tiredness out of the equation. On top of that, you also have, there was a lack of belief, my perceived lack of performance as a chef, as a leader, a lacking confidence. That was also pretty much taken care of in the early days with drugs, which gave a false sense of energy, direction, ability, bolstered confidence massively. Seemed to give an increased sense of the ability to lead a team of people.
While Philip Howard is prepared to talk about his experience in the hope that it will prevent someone else from doing the same or to seek help if they already are, there seems to be a general reluctance to discuss the subject in Australia.
We surveyed a good cohort of apprentices to have a look at their alcohol usage, and we were surprised at how often young people were drinking socially, and in some cases it was to a dangerous level. So, you know, we've developed a number of strategies around that to ensure that apprentices are aware of a healthy or well-being approach to their lifestyle and their job.
Operating in New South Wales, the ACT and Victoria, the group training organisation HTN supplies the hospitality and related industries with quality apprentices and trainees.
We work with about 250 businesses at the moment. That's small to medium enterprise to large venues as well. And we actually vet those establishments prior to placing apprentices with them. So we make sure that they're aware as to what our drug and alcohol policy is and provide them with a template or something they can plagiarise if they don't have their own.
One group which does offer help is Beyond Blue, the Melbourne-based National Depression Initiative, which aims to raise the awareness of various mental health and related issues. Their research shows that nearly one in five Australians experiences problems with substance abuse.
Yeah, so I think one of the first things to do is perhaps gather some more information. So there's lots of information that's available, say, for example, through us at Beyond Blue. We've got a website and a 24-hour-a-day, 7-day-a-week telephone line. We've got a range of free resources that can build people's knowledge and understanding of mental health problems. So if people are concerned, they can check out some of those things. If someone's feeling really concerned, one of the best things to do is go and see their doctor, exactly the same way that they would if they were concerned about any other aspect of their health. And I think if a manager's concerned, they can, you know, it's a good idea to have a conversation about their concerns. We've got a couple of programs at Beyond Blue as well. We've got our National Workplace Program, which delivers face-to-face training for employees and employers about how to recognise these problems at work and also how to have those conversations with people that you're concerned about. And we're also, we've got another program running at the moment for small to medium enterprises in terms of helping business owners think about how they can improve mental health understanding across their businesses and how they can improve their skills in actually being able to manage those problems at work.
Some initiatives from Beyond Blue. And this is the number and website you should definitely note down if you or someone you know has a problem. Last word for now to Philip Howard. And our thanks to him for being so upfront.
You know, the daily life of an ambitious young cook in a hard kitchen is just incredibly hard and grinding. And we all need, you know, to have a happy, sustainable life. We all need balance of some sort. And the truth is, you cannot achieve a balanced life as a young, hardworking chef de partie. There just isn't sufficient time off. Or finances available to try and tip the scales of balance back in your favour.
In a moment, penalty rates. Are they forcing some restaurants to close on Sundays?
Open kitchens with lots of stainless steel are great, but only if they look the part. I make sure mine does by using these Chucks stainless steel wipes. Every day here at Boschetti, we go through the simple three-step process. One, using a Chucks Super Wipe, we remove any excess grime and dust. Two, we clean the surface with Chucks stainless steel wipes to apply a protective coating. And three, we quickly buff it with a Chucks Super Wipe for a smudge-free finish. Brilliant in every way, but that's Chucks, isn't it?
Most days, kitchens are hectic places and there's no time to think. You have to rely on proven performers. That's when well-known and respected brands come into play. Brands like Heinz, with their satay sauce and condiments range. In convenient resealable jars for easy dispensing and spreading, Heinz satay sauce and condiments have been prepared from the finest quality ingredients and are great accompaniments for any catering purpose. So when it's hectic, it has to be Heinz.
It's like this. All Baxter's Bambaleo char-grilled vegetables are marinated in canola oil, herbs and spices before they char-grill them. Others char-grill first, then marinate. Not so good. With Bambaleo, all the beautiful flavour of the marinade is soaked up prior to char-grilling. That gives Baxter's Bambaleo char-grilled vegetables superior flavour. I suppose you could say it's locked in. You can really taste the Baxter's difference.
Take the Baxter's Bambaleo taste test today. Call John Lockery on 03 9357 6288 and you'll taste the difference Baxter's make.
The Hospitality Industry General Award for 2010 was one of over 120 introduced at the beginning of that year and now is up to an interim review. In the run-up to this, a number of prominent restaurateurs have spoken out about penalty rates, claiming they've forced some fully booked restaurants to close on Sundays and public holidays to avoid trading at a loss. We look at both sides of the argument.
The three-hat Vue du Monde on the 55th floor of Melbourne's Rialto Tower is not struggling at weekends, but its successful Café Vue at the Hardy Museum of Modern Art barely breaks even on Sundays, its biggest trading day, because of wage costs.
Bottom line is that people want to dine on a Sunday, they want to dine on a public holiday, but they don't want to pay more for that service. And that's fair enough. We understand that the marketplace does not want to pay more for the same thing on a Sunday as they might during the week. But the reality that the consumer doesn't understand is that it's costing us a lot more money to put the food on the plate, to actually service the guests and to open the doors. So it's definitely a consideration, I believe, for all hospitality venues and one that we have to bear in mind as we move forward.
A survey at the beginning of this year by the Restaurant and Catering Association found that staffing costs are the greatest barrier to business development. The cost of wages, including on costs, has grown from 35.7% to 44% of turnover in the past 5 years.
The Fair Work Act does contain a review process every 4 years for modern awards, but because the Act is new, there is a two-year process that's been put in place by the government. And we simply believe that it's too late to wait for 4 years on this round. If we were to wait 4 years, we may actually find that a number of companies go under because these high penalty rates are causing a lot of problems. Already in southeast Queensland, a number of our members no longer trade on weekends because of the high penalty rates. And we're concerned that may start to follow around the rest of the country.
They are certainly fighting rising food costs, let alone the economic downturn, because there have only been a few markets, if you like, or channels within the food service market that have been the winners during the economic downturn. Most outlets, most operators have certainly felt the economic downturn, felt the uncertain time, because eating out is discretionary spending, so although Australians have made eating out a way of life, we're not going out as often anymore, and we're not spending as much each time, but we still want to go out. But the channels that have benefited from that has been the fast food chains, the very lower end of the restaurant market, as well as the clubs.
We have a very diverse and I guess broad business. People who may have one operation are very often working hands-on in the business. They're often doing their own payroll, their own accounting, their own books, and then they're running the restaurant floor and dealing with all the other issues that they have. So to then take on board the complexities of the award is a very big challenge for them. So that's one of the reasons why we're out talking about this, is because we hope that a lot of our staff go on to one day run their own venues, which will inevitably be one venue to start with, and we know how hard it can be to strip back and understand all the different complexities of the award and make sure that you're compliant and doing the right thing.
Despite dire warnings of cities becoming ghost towns at weekends, if restaurants and cafes are forced to close, United Voice, the union representing hospitality workers, is sticking to its argument and warning that not too much is likely to come out of the interim review.
State is that the industry just 2 years ago actually ran four major cases through the Industrial Tribunal of Australia, Fair Work Australia. Four times it fronted that tribunal trying to argue this case, and four times it was comprehensively defeated. So it's not as if these arguments haven't been in the public domain or even in the legal jurisdiction quite recently and argued quite deeply. And in all those occasions, Fair Work Australia, the independent arbiter, looked at all the arguments and came down on saying, no, this is an industry of low wages, working 24/7. It does need compensation for the workers, and there does need to be a fit. Yes, we need a viable industry, but the viability shouldn't be at the cost of decent wages and conditions.
What we're looking for is a flat rate of pay. So we think that would make it a lot easier to administer and certainly to predict and to cost, so that you can be running a successful operation. So I guess at the moment we're looking for something in the middle between what we pay during the week and what we pay on a Saturday, Sunday or public holiday. So a rate that would take into account someone who may work on a Sunday and actually amortise that across the whole week. So at the moment the gap is, say, between during the week you're looking at around $17 an hour. If you go to Sundays, you're looking in the $25 and $30 an hour range. So something that sits more fairly in the middle of those two and can be applied across the week.
Penalty rates have historically been a recompense and a recognition that people are giving up something that others would like to be doing at that time. And great example, when was the New Zealand rugby finals held? It was held on a Sunday night, because that's when people generally expect to be home with their families, in a leisure environment. Now, if you ask people to go out of that environment and go to work, there's got to be some recompense. From the restaurateur's point of view, they want certainty that people will turn up, so there's got to be an attraction for people to come to work. And secondly, for workers, there's got to be some reward for not being with family, friends, being able to be part of what is normal community activity.
Even employees are saying, and there was an ABC documentary recently in Canberra where, you know, a number of ACT employees in a cafe environment were saying that, look, they would much prefer to be paid their ordinary rates on weekends but get the shift, get the gig, rather than, you know, if they're forced, you know, their employer's forced to pay them up to $40 an hour because of the high penalty rates. It's just not viable, so they're not getting the work. So, you know, it works both ways, but there needs to be an ability to, you know, to make that kind of system work.
Both sides of a very contentious issue. We should know the outcome early in 2012. There are many Australians working in Southeast Asia in the hospitality industry, but few have a bigger job on their hands than Rick Stephen. Tasmanian born and bred, Rick is the executive chef at Singapore-based airline caterer SATS, where he oversees nearly 400 chefs in 12 kitchens, producing tens of thousands of meals a day. He is also the Continental Director Asia for the World Association of Chef Societies. In our Nestle professional sponsored Let's Talk, we caught up with Rick during a quick visit to Sydney.
I used to come to work at 5 o'clock in the morning before anyone else would come in, just to learn my way around the kitchens. Because the kitchen, it's so big that it's pretty hard to explain to you unless you see it. And I'd come in so I could walk all the way around the kitchen and know where I am. And that was the first thing, because it was 12 different kitchens and a production kitchen and all those. It's just huge. And then slowly, and then I get to, and one of the policies, even when I was with the Hilton, I had this policy that you start work on a good day. So I try and shake hands with as many people as I can to start the work with. I said, if we have a row or if I get upset or you get upset, before you leave, you come and shake hands before you go, because I don't want you to take the problems home with you. And that's a policy I've had when I was, as I said, with the Hilton, Brisbane Club and all that. And that's that's what I introduced there with as many chefs as I possibly can. And so to build up a relationship with my team was quite interesting then. At least they had the respect that I'd come around to see them. And I'd walk the floor 2 or 3 times a day. So that was my start there.
What's it like? What's the difference between working in an Australian kitchen at the Brisbane Club or with the Hilton and working where you are now?
Well, obviously it's the volume for the start with, the volume. But I think it's working with Asians, it's quite interesting because I find that they have a higher integrity, have a lot of family values and a lot of respect, a lot about showing face. If you treat them well, they treat you well.
They don't want to lose face though, do they?
Definitely don't want to lose face. And if they muck up, for instance, it's a way how you counsel them. Like if I yelled at them in a group, they would lose face, and some people would show that I showed that I had no respect for them. So the way it happens is that we do it. If you do something wrong, I ask you to come to the office. We come down, we sit down, and we talk about it. And it's not a matter of yelling. It's a matter of just saying, this is the problem, it's ABC, how are we going to fix it?
How good are Asian chefs?
Depends on the cuisine. Teaching them flavors a little bit is something new for them, but you take my Oriental chef. He goes to Beijing to teach them how to cook Chinese when there's problems there. My Japanese chef, I think from a finesse point of view, he's fantastic. Cooks everything right through. He's in the kitchen all the time. But my Indian chef, I could cook a pile of spices together and he could just about tell you every single spice is in there by taste.
No doubt about it. That's a hospitality job that could give you nightmares, but Rick seems to be reveling in the challenge. Now have a look at this. When Ian Holmes from Melbourne booked a special birthday lunch for his wife at a Sydney leading restaurant, he didn't quite get what he bargained for.
The entree that came out was absolutely beautiful. You know, no complaints, was perfect. But unfortunately, the disappointing part for us was when the main course came out. My wife had her dish, which was absolutely beautiful and well proportioned. And my dish came out and it was like, oh, I looked at it. And the look of disappointment on my face was unbelievable, you know, like I wanted more. It was, to be honest, it was on the big plate, as you always get at these type of restaurants, But no word of a lie, it was no bigger than a credit card.
Ian got his phone out and began taking photos of the dish. When he said he was going to post it on Facebook, the staff just about fell over themselves to put things right. A look at the impact that social media is having on the restaurant business coming up.
Hi, I'm Pete DePino, executive chef at Nestle Professional. Producing signature desserts is much easier with the help of Nestle dessert mixes. And take my favorite, Nestle Panna Cotta dessert mix. You can go from this to this, a honey and peach panna cotta, in about a fraction of the time it takes you to make one from scratch. Like all of the delicious Nestle dessert mixes in our range, they are quick, simple, and very cost-effective to prepare. Try them. I'm betting you won't be disappointed.
Each program, we're featuring an editor from one of the food service industry publications and asking them what trends they are seeing in the business. When I met with Ella Wright from Open House, sustainability was at the top of her list.
Sustainability, I think, means different things to different people. But at its simplest level, it's about using resources in a way that conserves them for future generations. Now, that might be something as simple as just reducing the amount of food waste that goes to landfill, because it's actually a really major source of greenhouse gases. So if we can cut down on that, then, you know, we're helping the environment in that way.
And for an operation, or say a smaller, for a cafe or restaurant, is it economically viable, say if I ran a cafe, to be under the banner of sustainability?
I think what you have to remember really is that while there are lots of different elements and lots of different things you can do, you don't have to tackle it all at once. So certainly there are inexpensive and easily implementable things that smaller businesses or businesses of any size can do. So just start small and, you know, sort of work up with what you're comfortable.
So if I'm running a cafe, a restaurant, I probably have about, you know, 50 tables, or 50 covers. How would I start? Where would I start?
Okay, well, I mean, fair trade is a really good thing for businesses to get involved with. And that is a program basically that pays farmers in poor developing countries a fair price for goods such as sugar and coffee, enabling them to both sort of build their own industry but also their community. So it's not charity, but it's helping them help themselves. Closer to home, you could sign up for a food rescue organisation like Oz Harvest, and they will come and collect leftover food and redistribute it to you know, charities that deal with disadvantaged people. You could talk to your suppliers of your produce about the amount of packaging, food waste. You know, packaging is a huge problem. A lot of those suppliers will actually come to the party and either change the way they package their food or come and pick it back up from you for reuse. So that's something you might want to look at as well.
Now I know why Baxter's Argent's Hill Pestos are so highly regarded for their quality and flavour profile. It's because at Baxter's they taste test and score each batch they produce. And if it doesn't pass their stringent quality standards, it's binned. So take the taste test and score your own batch. You can taste the Baxter's difference.
To take the Baxter's Argent's Hill taste test, call John Lockery on 03 9357 6288, and you'll taste the difference Baxter's Argent's Hill makes.
We've all heard the saying, you get what you pay for, and that goes for cleaning cloths as well. Take this spill, for instance, one pass with a Chuck Super Wipe and it's gone. The double action holes absorb the liquid and trap the dirt. Chucks are strong, hygienic, and 100% reusable. You can wash them time and time again, and they still do the job long after cheaper brands are in the bin. For me, Chucks is the real deal.
Whether you like it or not, social media has changed the way most industries operate, including hospitality. Facebook, Twitter, Flickr, Food Gawker, and the like are having a big impact, particularly in the restaurant scene, and you run the real risk of being left behind if you're not up to speed. we took a crash course.
Chin Chin in Flinders Lane in Melbourne CBD opened in May, serving a traditional Thai menu.
In terms of social media, I was brought on before the opening, just for lead up, and I started all the accounts and tried to find the people who are interested and who are in these fields to get some traction. And it basically, we opened expecting to do 150 on a Friday night as a busy service. We opened on a Monday and had 150 people in on a Monday night, half the room, which were from Twitter.
Already it has a large following on both Twitter and Facebook and updates both multiple times each day.
We have a different drink every day. It's a coconut crush. It's an, you know, coconut juice that we blend with fruit and herbs, and it changes every day. And it could just be a conversation of, we have too much soy milk and too much chocolate powder. Let's make a bounty crush. And then it might be an argument and it'll, you know, turn into something ridiculous that'll go online and people will come in and order it.
I think the thing about restaurants is they're not used to computers or all that sort of technology. So to them it's a bit baffling. So a lot of them nowadays, we've seen a sharp fall in consumer confidence. The average occupancy of a table is 36%. A lot of restaurants now have this knee-jerk reaction that I want to get people through my doors. They know that the fastest way you can get people to come in directly is through social media. But what they don't know is that it takes 3 to 6 months to build up your presence and earn the respect of the people that follow you to pay attention to you. So it seems a lot of them are doing too little, too late.
Ed Charles is a Melbourne-based restaurant and social media consultant who says operators have little choice but to move with the times.
You're lucky if you get a review in a year. You're lucky if you get a review, you probably won't be reviewed for 2 years. So how else do you get the reach and frequency in getting the information of about your restaurant or your business out there? Well, you use social media. And they're starting to realise that comments online aren't scary, they're actually positive, and they're actually free market research. But it's only really just started happening this year and there's still a lot of confusion.
Some restaurant operators love social media, others are paranoid, even going as far as to ban food photography.
Pictures are probably one of the best interfaces to get the message across about the food or drink in a restaurant because they're an instant visual hit like that. As you know, they say a picture paints 1,000 words. It really does. And I think that's one of the most exciting areas of the social media interface to exploit for anyone in the food business. Because you can tell your story through ingredients, through cooking, through the final dishes, and you can do it simply just by taking pictures on your iPhone.
We have no problem with it here. We're easy, we're casual, relaxed. You know, that's what it's based on. And we do encourage people to have a good experience. We don't want to say no to people. I'm happy for people to take photos, especially because, you know, I come from a background of blogging. I think the only thing that gets to me is when people physically have something in front of them and can't visually identify what it is.
Then there are those bad reviews, with some owners accusing rivals of doing the dirty and posting bad reviews on consumer review sites like Your Restaurants, Eatability and Urban Spoon.
They're very easy to identify because you'll see someone that's given a 10-page commentary on Urban Spoon where people really do just give 50 words and leave, and they seem to comment on everything, on service, on, you know, what they've eaten, why they don't like it, but they don't quite identify it. And then all of a sudden you're like, oh, you've done one review. They're very easy to spot. And I think people who do use these sites are smart enough to be able to tell.
So is there a legal comeback? John Fairburn from Minter Ellison in Sydney specialises in intellectual property.
I think the real issue is that, you know, if you're engaged in legal proceedings, if you're forced to go down that avenue, that there are costs associated with that, which makes pursuing those legal avenues unpalatable to a lot of smaller organisations.
Social media is a new marketing channel. You still have to do the same old marketing things. You can't ignore old media because you still want to get in the restaurant guides or get a hat from one of those guides or whatever it is, and be reviewed if you can. But social media is the way to get directly to your customers and drag them in. And if you're not going to do it, the place next door to you is.
Thanks for watching and for all the comments about the first show. For more information on the products featured, just click the products tab on this website. We'll be back with more industry stories early in the new year. Until then, season's greetings from the Hello team and all the best in 2012.